A very warm welcome to today's session brought to you by Team Grade Up. I hope you all are doing really well. Through the course of this lecture, we'd be looking at a very interesting work by Fyodor Dostoevsky, who is a cult writer when we are talking about world literature, of course, originating from Russia. Now, Crime and Punishment is an extremely important work that we all must remember, not just because of the fact that we get questions from Dostoevsky's works, but also the fact that this was one of the most important works to talk about psychological aspects. It is considered to be an important murder mystery, despite the fact that we are already aware about from the very beginning who has committed the crime. You know, this was actually a disguised murder mystery. And why was it a disguised murder mystery? Because of the fact that we were able to see that in reality, Dostoevsky wanted to present about the conditions that were prevalent when we are talking about, when we are discussing about St. Petersburg, okay? So please keep that in mind. Do remember that. That is something which is extremely crucial. Through the course of today's lecture, what all will we be focusing on? We will, of course, be focusing on looking at Crime and Punishment. We will try to analyze it. We will, of course, look at the character of Raskolnikov. We'll discuss important characters who are there in the novel. Along with that, we'll also discuss how we are finding this entire character, like, you know, Raskolnikov, who's representing St. Petersburg society. Now, there was a very interesting question that was there asked in one of your exams, that was, what was the original intention of Crime and Punishment? The original intention was actually the original work that Dostoevsky had written, that was The Drunk, right? So he was talking about how in St. Petersburg people were literally poverty stricken, and in order to not really be worried about the conditions, they were trying to be in a constant drunken state. Remember what was happening with Coleridge. Coleridge was an opium addict, not because of the fact that his addiction was something that started on very early, because of the fact that he was unwell. And thus he had to keep himself. Those were like kind of painkillers, right? So looking at alcoholism, especially alcoholism amidst poverty, was a very important theme that we are able to see in Crime and Punishment, okay? So we will discuss those exciting things. Additionally, we will have a very quick quiz of 25 questions. It's like a rapid fire quiz of 25 questions, followed by a proper investigation of Crime and Punishment. And you know, from today onwards, what I'll do is, whatever will be left over, for instance, if there will be any part which will not be able to complete in Crime and Punishment, I will share it with you in the form of a very quick video, say about 3 to 5 minutes video on the Telegram channel. So make sure that you are noting down things, and you know, you can have your notes at one area only. Okay, so don't worry. Let's just try to complete as much as possible. And the remaining on Crime and Punishment, I will share it on the Telegram platform along with the PDF. You can just connect on the Telegram platform. It's Nirja UGC Net English. So let's very quickly dive into and get started. This is the first question. Let's see how many of you are able to answer it. And remember, palinode basically means, because the first question is a question on palinode. Palinode means I'm saying no. First I say yes, this party is good. Then I say no, this party is not good. So when I recant, that is when I'm using a palinode. So here goes your first question. Let's see how many of you are able to answer it. Okay, look at the question correctly. These are your options. Let's see very, very quickly. Yes, I agree. So that, you know, your notes can actually be compiled at one area itself. That's the intention. So don't worry about that. Okay, let's see how many of you are able to get the right answer. Dash is regarded as a palinode retraction of a statement from an earlier poem to Yeats's poem, September 1913. What is the right answer here? What becomes the right answer here? Excellent, fantastic. Most of you have got it right. Most of you have got it right. See, basically, when we are talking about William Butler Yeats, William Butler Yeats was always talking about fighting against the hegemonic British control via writing. He was not subscribing to violent methods of MacBride. He was not subscribing to violent methods of Montcalm. He was not really happy with the kind of violent methods that these people were using. However, in Eastern 19th 1916, we're able to see that he's actually commemorating the people who had actually made sure that, you know, they were getting killed for the sake of the country. So he's also paying a tribute to those people. So we are able to see, we're able to look at how he is trying to recant his views. He's trying to recant his views. So in Easter 1916, do remember, we are able to see that he is trying to go against the fact that, you know, what he was talking about, violence. Not that he believed in violence, no, not at all. But yes, he of course was paying a tribute to people who had lost their lives for the Irish cause of independence, right? The Irish cause of independence is the backdrop over here in this Yeatsian poem. There are multiple questions out of the 25 questions on Yeats and T.S. Eliot. So today only, go back home. I will also send some more material on Yeats and T.S. Eliot so that all of you can revise these two poets, okay? Let's come on to the second question. Yeats's poem, No Second Troy, is an angry attack on. It is an angry attack on. Whom was it attacking? Right? No Second Troy. And this is, of course, I don't think most of you will get it wrong. All of you should get it right. Absolutely, Kompal. The Legend of Good Women was also a kind of a palinode that was written. Why was it a palinode? Because he was recanting whatever he had presented in terms of women as unfaithful in Troilus and Cresseid. So he was trying to recant that opinion in The Legend of Good Women. Absolutely. Okay, so here I think, yes, I can see like a barrage of you answering it correctly. Maud Gonne is the right answer. No Second Troy. He was comparing beautiful women in history like Helen of Troy, Maud Gonne. And basically the illusion is that Maud Gonne is also one of the women who will cause a lot of destruction eventually. That is what you're able to see. So No Second Troy. And you know, you've got questions come directly three times in your NET exams from No Second Troy, even though it is a very simple work, okay? So please keep that in mind. Whenever we are looking at works like A Prayer for My Daughter or No Second Troy, in this he's criticizing Maud Gonne. He's criticizing the stubbornness of women. A Prayer for My Daughter is also a work for my daughter, is also a work wherein he's trying to look at all these aspects, look at all these themes collectively. So do remember it, okay? This is important. Let's come on to the next question. This is the third question. Dash is Yeats's daughter for whom A Prayer for My Daughter was written. A Prayer for My Daughter was written, okay? And I will give you a hint also. Isworld, okay, let's see how many of you are able to answer it. What is the right answer? I'll give you a very short hint. Maud Gonne had rejected. Maud Gonne said, no, I don't want to get married to you. Okay, so Maud Gonne had said no. All right. Then he waited for Maud Gonne's daughter Isuel to grow big. And Isuel also said no. That is when he finally decided, okay, fine, now let me just get married. Okay. So that is the story of William Butler Yeats. Absolutely. And Butler Yeats. That's true. Who's given this? Hemlata Mishra has given the entire answer. Hemlata. Very good. Hemlata Mishra is right. Anne Butler Yeats is the correct answer. Anne is the correct answer. So when Anne was born, he was writing A Prayer for My Daughter. So No Second Troy and A Prayer for My Daughter, criticizing the destructive potential of femininity, the destructive potential of beauty that is getting criticized over here. Okay, fantastic. Okay, let's very quickly get to the next question. This is question number 4. In the sonnet dash, Yeats presents two modes of thought, Western intellectual and Oriental mystic. Okay, so in which sonnet? And the hint is over here. The hint is over here. What is the right answer? What is the right answer? Good evening, everyone. Okay, what is the right answer? Which work, right? In the sonnet dash, Yeats presents two. Yeats is presenting two modes of thought, Western intellectual and Oriental mystical. And Oriental mystical, okay? Be very careful. I can see A, B, C, D. Everyone's answered all sorts of things. Okay, just make sure that, you know, you are trying to look at it correctly and then you're trying to answer it. Okay. But yeah, the hint basically is in the word sonnet. The hint basically that you are having over here is in the form of the word sonnet that you are having, right? And this particular work is actually an extremely important work. It's a very small, short little poem that is trying to talk about this entire... Okay. All right. Okay, see, some of you, I can see some of you have written Byzant scriptorium as the answer, the Lake Isles of Inspree. See, first of all, use the elimination method, okay? In the sonnet, Yeats presents two modes of thought, the Western intellectual and the Oriental mystical. So this is basically a very, it wasn't a very famous and renowned work, but later on with the advent of Oriental studies and the appetite that people had developed for post-colonial literature, people had started focusing on this work, okay? Now, when you're talking about, for instance, Yeats was always having this notion, especially that is conveyed in Sailing to Byzantium also, that, you know, that there is always this place which is idyllic, and the same idea comes in Lake Isles of Inspree, which was actually inspired by the American Transcendentalist, but it's not talking about Western intellectual and Oriental mystical. This is also not the right answer. The right answer is Meru. Leda and the Swan is talking about the tyranny of people like Zeus also indirectly. So Leda and the Swan is also telling you about the tyrannical figures like Zeus in connection. But Meru becomes the right answer. Meru becomes the right answer over here. Please remember. Now Meru was not a very very well known poem, or it wasn't always included. You know, for Yeats and for T.S. Eliot, every time your professors will always prescribe you with the Oxford University Press edition. There is this Oxford University Press edition. There's a black, white color book which has modern poetry anthologies of Yeats and T.S. Eliot, and they have got an anthology. It's very readily available in bookshops also at universities. I think it's for 130 rupees. But in that anthology, also in the introduction part, it's mentioned that now Meru, works like Meru have started becoming very popular. Why works like Meru have started becoming popular? Because now we've all have developed we've developed this so-called hunger, appetite for post-colonial writings, Oriental works, which is telling us about differentiation, us versus them theme. That is what you're able to see over here. Okay, chalo, let's come on to the next question. Question number 5. In which poem does Yeats give a vignette of himself, a 60-year-old man, smiling public man? Very simple question. I'm hoping all of you should get it right. Very, very simple question. And yet, this work, this poem has also come multiple times in your exam, in your NET exam also. Okay, let's see. Good evening, everyone. Thank you, Kalpana. That's very sweet of you, bachche. God bless you. Okay, chalo, jaldi se batao, what is the right answer? Also, tomorrow your class at 7 p.m. might not take place because tomorrow I'm going finally, you know, the lazy family of mine, we are finally going for our jabs. So, depending upon how my body reacts, so let's just hope it reacts in a better manner. But irrespective, definitely day after, whatever, come rain, come hailstorm, I will definitely take your class. But tomorrow there might be a shift in timings, but don't worry, I will compensate that by taking extra sessions, okay? So don't worry. Excellent. Very good. Among school children is the right answer. So, you know, he was actually this public person. He was a kind of a school inspector. He's going back, and when he's looking at the fact that his role as a school inspector, he's looking at those children, he's reminded of his past life. Remember all these 20th century poets, writers, the essayists, they're all talking about how time is never linear. It'll take you to ages. Right? Even William Butler Yeats, for example, goes to classical myths, goes to Greek myths, comes back, has invented his own theory of the gyres. Remember, what is he talking about? He's talking about the gyres theory. And according to him, it is all like a gyres. It comes full circle. So many people right now are talking about the fact that, you know, how similar pandemics have taken place in the past also. It is not something which is unique, which is only happening to us. It's happened multiple times in history also. So what is that? That is an example of the gyre theory, that history repeats itself. After a period of time, we're able to see that history is repeating itself. All right? That is a thing that we're able to observe. Okay, excellent. Let's come on to the 6th question quickly. It was Dash who brought French symbolism to the attention of Yeats. The minute you get symbolism, I think you should get the answer. Very simple question again. Let's see how many of you are able to answer it. Thank you. Thank you. Who's this? Thank you. Thank you, Kompal. Thank you, Deepika. You guys are making it sound as if, like, you know, there's an injection. As it is, I'm like, you know, a needle phobiac person. And by writing all the very best, you're scaring me further, huh? Okay. Anyway. Okay, fantastic. That is the right answer. See, bachche, the trick is very simple. Majority of time, 9 out of 10 cases, whenever you get a question that which writer is introducing symbolism to the English, it is Arthur Symons. Arthur Symons, in 9 out of 10 cases, whenever you get a question related to symbolism, Arthur Symons will be the right answer. Arthur Symons was introducing, he was getting symbolism to the English folk. Symbolism became the heartbeat of modern poetry, particularly the poetry of T.S. Eliot, was very inspired by the symbolist movement. Okay, so the French symbolist movement that we are having, Arthur Symons is actually getting it. Excellent, excellent. Let's come on to the next question. This is question number 7, very quickly for all of you. Yeats's poem Byzantium is a response to the criticism of its companion piece Sailing to Byzantium by. What is the right answer? Okay, Ria, let's see. I think, okay, Aftara's like, it's a matter of 5 seconds. Yeah, I'm just worried because, you know, I'm going through the office people, so I'm just worried I don't make a mockery of myself, because the minute, you know, I'm completely unaware about how I will react, and the minute I'll be like, something like that, I get crazy sometimes. So yeah. Excellent, fantastic. So some of you have got the right answer. Okay, some of you have got the right answer. Now, why this question is very important for all of you? This question is very important because Byzantium was actually a place that was very dear to the notion that was there in Yeats's mind. So Yeats was actually taking out, Sailing to Byzantium was also work that Yeats was writing, but he was also responding to the criticism that was given, right? To the criticism that was given. Now, please remember, Yeats was a person who was inventing his own mythology. Why was he inventing his own mythology? Because he, like Blake, was a sui generis. Just like Blake, even William Butler Yeats was a sui generis. Sui generis of his own kind. He was of his own kind. He was a person who was actually inventing his own mythology. Okay, and here what you have to basically keep in mind is that Moore's work, okay, S.T. Serge Moore's work was criticizing this notion of Byzantium. See, they were also not wrong in their criticism. They were saying that you can actually not find a perfect place. They were saying you can actually not find a perfect place ever. Even the most perfectly successful places that we've seen aren't really successful, aren't really the best of the places. So the very concept was getting attacked. Okay, so that is something that you can keep in mind. All right, let's come on to the 8th question. In which literary magazine was The Wasteland first published in England? The Wasteland was first published in England in which literary magazine? Which literary magazine? Very simple question. I think everyone should get it right. No one should get this question wrong. Oh God, all of you are scaring me, huh? Majority of you. Riya's got all the side effects. Deepika's got all the side effects. Okay. So, let's see. Okay, fantastic, fantastic. Everyone has got it right. I don't think this even, you know, this should actually come to your mind even when you are sleeping, that the work like Wasteland was published in the Criterion. All right. So that is something, you know, this question still, however, you'll be able to see it in some of your entrances. It still comes, and it's always a good idea for you to keep it in mind. Okay. Let's come on to the 9th question. Eliot took the words of the dedication of Wasteland from the dedication, which is there in the Wasteland. Where are you able to see that the dedication is coming from? Which place? Okay, this is also a pretty simple question. Yes, Kompal. Yes, yes, yes. They were publishing. So Virginia Woolf as well as Leonard Woolf, right? They were responsible. Okay, let's see how many of you get it right. Eliot took the words of dedication of the Wasteland from. Where was he taking these words from? Some of you have given the right answer. Okay, yes. It is Purgatory in Dante's Divine Comedy. So when we are talking about Dante's Divine Comedy, the works are, the dedication part is taken from this, okay? I will share a handout, a PDF with all of you on the Telegram channel today on Yeats and T.S. Eliot. Just go over that, and these kind of questions will be a cakewalk after that. I don't think you will have a lot of problems, and if you'll still have doubts, then I'll make notes myself from the handout and I will share it with all of you so that all of you are very, very clear about this, okay? Let's come on to the next question. Question number 10. Dash parodied Ash Wednesday as Cinder Thursday. Cinder Thursday. Okay. Ash Wednesday is famously called as the conversion poem. What is it famously called as? It's called as the conversion poem because after this we were able to see that he had got himself converted. Okay. Let's see how many of you are able to answer it. Chalo. Fatafat. Let's quickly see. Right. A is the right answer. Majority of you have got the right answer. Okay, I'm saying A is not the right answer. Herbert Palmer is the right answer. Herbert Palmer is the right answer. Okay, so Herbert Palmer is the right answer. Cinder Thursday, Ash Wednesday. Whenever we are talking about T.S. Eliot, he was getting himself converted. He was an American, but then he acquired British citizenship. He was also a person who converted himself into classicism. He was really associated. You know, basically a lot of people, a lot of professors also will always keep on telling you about the fact that how T.S. Eliot was a part of the very limited aristocracy which was still remaining, which still wanted to control culture, wanted to say that, you know, we aristocratic people have always controlled, or we have always maintained the culture and we've always preserved it, so even we are equally important. That was the notion. So Herbert Palmer is the right answer. Herbert Palmer is the right answer for Cinder Thursday. Coming on to the 11th question, who condemned The Wasteland as a crossword puzzle of synthetic literary chronology of spurious verbal algebra? Okay, and this is actually true. But unfortunately, he is using the same weapon used by T.S. Eliot, crossword puzzle of synthetic literary chronology of spurious verbal algebra. Okay, so who was this person who was vastly criticized? Yes, Lakshmi, very good. That is true. So who is this person who was critical, who condemned The Wasteland? Yes, even he was critical. But this particular quotation, where is this quotation coming from? This is coming from Wendham Lewis. Wendham Lewis was critical. This question, questions like these are a part of your literary criticism. Please be mindful. Please be aware about this. Okay, these kind of questions, such questions are basically coming from your literary criticism. Okay, let's come on to the 12th question. From where did Eliot take the title of The Wasteland? Very simple question. From where did he get the title The Wasteland? From where was he actually taking this entire title? You know, this question, all of you should write it on your notepads itself. It's a very important question and you should not go wrong with this question at all. Okay? Yes, that is the right answer. Majority of you, Garima, Priyanka, Nonak, then Abhirami, Abhi, that is right. Prerna Patkar Bachi, these are questions, the quiz questions today are coming from the poetry of William Butler Yeats and T.S. Eliot. So far, we have spoken about questions related to T.S. Eliot. You can make a note, Prerna Patkar Bachi. What all questions have we discussed up till now, Prerna Bachi? First question that we discussed, first or the second question that we discussed, in which particular magazine, literary magazine, did you have The Wasteland published? So Criteria was the right answer. Then the second we had looked at, where was the dedication taken from? So The Wasteland, the work is having the dedication, just like, you know, for example, Prerna Patkar is writing a work, so she will dedicate the work. So where is the dedication coming from? So that dedication was coming from Purgatory of Dante's Divine Comedy. Very simple questions, Bache, so far. Okay. Then now this question that has come, this particular question is basically the crux, Prerna. It is a very important question. It is asking you, from where are we getting the title, or forget about the title, even the gist of it. It is actually from James Frazer's The Golden Bough. The Golden Bough was actually a compendium. It was a collection. It was a collection of all the myths that had come together. And that is exactly what we are able to see. Then there was a question, Bache Prerna, which was asking that who has mentioned that this particular work is nothing more than, more than just being wordplay, everything being, it is a synthetic literary history. That is the word that you're able to look at, okay? So, Bache, please remember that these are questions that we are looking at from William Butler Yeats and T.S. Eliot, okay? So that is what you have to remember, and here D is the right answer. Very simple questions. Let's look at question number 13 very quickly. From where did Eliot take the epigraph of the Wasteland? Sure, Deepika, I will take this suggestion going forward also. And now onwards, all your quiz questions will be based, they will be either writer-wise or they will be age-wise. They'll be thematically connected, okay? So that all of you are able to make a question bank of yourself, okay? So that is a very valid point. We have taken a note of that, Deepika, okay? Don't worry. Chalo, let's very quickly come on to this question and see how many of you are able to answer it. Is it hang? Has it hanged? Okay. Somehow my screen has frozen. Are you able to see me? Sorry, my screen froze and therefore I was not able to see your answers. Okay. Okay, from where did Eliot take the epigraph of the Wasteland? The epigraph is taken from Petronius Satyricon. Petronius's Satyricon is the place from where we are getting the epigraph. Okay, Petronius's Satyricon is a place, even in your spark notes, for example, even in your spark notes when you are attempting, the reading of spark notes or they are having a quiz. These kind of questions on the Wasteland are very easily available on that the SparkNotes quiz part also. So you can actually practice it if you wish to. If you're not a classroom student, then you can always take that question bank, which will really help you to understand where is your performance in terms of the Wasteland. Okay, and they're very simple questions, all of them, that usually come from the Wasteland. Let's look at the 14th question. Which is the shortest section of the Wasteland? Out of the 5 sections that we are having, which is the shortest section? Okay, Pramod. Okay, my screen had frozen. I could not see your answers. That is the reason. I could not see your answers. That was the major reason. Absolutely correct. Okay, death by water is the right answer. Death by water becomes the correct answer over here. Which is the shortest section of the Wasteland? The shortest section of the Wasteland is death by water. The shortest section that we are having is book 4, that is part 4, sorry, death by water. That is the shortest one. 15th question. Dash is Eliot's first published poem. This is Eliot's first published poem. What are we talking about? I think everyone should get this right. Each and every person over here should actually get it right, because remember, he actually ushered a generation of the likes of Proof Rock, wherein you were literally counting your days with the cigar, the cigar trashes all your way. So that is of course becoming important. Chalo, let's see how many of you get the right answer. Proof Rock is the right answer. The Love Song of J. Alfred Prufrock. The Love Song of J. Alfred Prufrock is the right answer. This was the first published poem that was written. Alright, so that is the correct answer. Perfect. Let's come on to the next question. Question number 16. In the poem Dash, Eliot gives us his interpretation of the birth of Bethlehem. Okay, in which poem, in this poem that we have, Eliot gives us his interpretation of the birth at Bethlehem. What is the work that we're talking about? Journey of Maggie, Hollow Man, Little Gidding, Dry Salvages, all of these are important works from your examination perspective. Okay, let's see how many of you get the right answer. And this is a very, very simple question. Isha Singh has got it, Avtara has got it right, Swati Jha has got it right, I can see very good. Shrabani Patnaik has also got it right. The journey of Maggie is the right answer. The journey of Maggie is the right answer. So that is the correct answer. Let's come on to the next question. Question number 17. The source for the story of Philomel in the Wasteland. Philomel's story in the Wasteland. Just go back today, revise Wasteland a little bit. I will also share some material, try to go over it once. And just make sure that you're compiling all your notes on the Wasteland at one particular area. It is a very simple work. In the coming days, even we will conduct sessions on Wasteland, which will make things even more clearer for all of you. But still, okay, let's see how many of you are able to answer this question correctly. What is the right answer? Excellent. The source for the story of Philomel. So there is a conversion, there is a transformation that has taken place, and metamorphosis becomes the right answer. Okay, there is a transformation that we have seen that has taken place, and metamorphosis becomes the correct answer that we are having over here. Okay, so please remember that. Okay, let's come on to the 18th question. In which part of the Wasteland does T.S. Eliot refer to Saint Augustine's visit to Carthage? Alright, in which part of the Wasteland does T.S. Eliot refer to Saint Augustine's visit to Carthage? What is the right answer? Okay, Saima Bhatt has asked a good question. Which is better, Course Hero, Spark Notes, Lit Chart? All the online resources, you'll have to make it a mixture, right? You will actually have to make it a mixture if you're looking at online resources. Some of them are very well written on Lit Chart. Some of them are very well written on e-notes. Some of them are very well written on... So, the best part is that now, unfortunately, because everyone's using Google Ads, so what happens is, so the minute you do a Google search, whenever you're doing a Google search, if you get the first ad, and you'll be able to see this adverb. So ADT is written, so that means that's an added search that is coming. But otherwise, if you just Google search so and so summary, so automatically you will be able to get the best sources. However, I can conduct a session on this also. It is always good to actually go over papers, okay? So you can type in for example, either you can say such and such work PDF, or what you can also do is you can just write down the name of the work and write Shuddh Ganga, or you can write down research paper. ResearchGate is also having very good papers now. Also, what you can do is, the best thing is to just go on the Telegram search history, okay? So what you can do is you can just go on the Telegram and search for that particular writer. You will get the relevant searches also in the various groups that are there, right? So that is also a good and interesting way. Now of course, that is about how you are using your free material. I can definitely help you out. I can share a tip video on that, on how you can use your free resources. And trust me, those free resources also, if used well, are very good. And actually, Wikipedia is also a very good churned out one. But it's always good that besides Wikipedia also, if you do something, okay, besides Wikipedia also, if you do something that will add Wikipedia, don't make your notes, read Wikipedia first to get a basic understanding. Once when you've got that basic understanding, Saima, then you can go for your Lit Charts, Course Hero, your Spark Notes, York Notes, Great Saver is also very good. There are multiple platforms now I can share, and some of the new ones also that I've got added are even better than the previous ones. So we can probably make a separate session on how you can use these free online material which is available, especially for your summaries. Okay, all right so what is the right answer over here for 18th part? What is the right answer? Did everyone get it? B is the right answer. The fire sermon. In which part of the Wasteland does Eliot refers to Saint Augustine's visit to Carthage? The fire sermon. Okay, let's come on to the 19th question. Eliot took the legend of the Holy Grail for the Wasteland from... Where was he taking the legend of the Holy Grail? Let's very quickly do it, because we have 5 more questions left. The 19th question. Yes, Payal, of course, as English literature students, you can do all sorts of internship programs, because you guys are already having a well-developed linguistic ability. Your linguistic ability is actually much better. Words which other people actually have to take the troubles of learning, you people have already developed that prowess. You're already having those skill sets which would be making a remarkable fit for multiple organizations and the internships that they offer. right? So for example, a lot of United, so the UNDP for instance, or a lot of these think tanks, like, you know, for example, the other day I was giving, I was just helping this student decide, and he was thinking that consultancy is only KPMG, Bain, BCG, McKinsey. No, consulting is also, you know, you're having consulting in social spaces also. So DASRA is a organization which helps big companies where they can invest their corporate social funds, right? The CSR funds that they're having, corporate social responsibility funds, where all can they invest? So companies like DASRA, company, and there are multiple others. There are multiple others. And you know, there are so many other consultants where, consultancies where, by consultancies, I mean, these are also big and reputed, renowned organizations where you can actually be a good fit, because they really want people like you who have the, you know, and the reason in your interviews you can always mention, this is exactly what I was telling yesterday during the mini modules class, that you guys are students of deconstruction. These people require you in their organizations because you will get radically new ideas. One of the students is currently working with the Oyo, with the Oyo group, the Oyo Rooms group, and she's doing really well. She's actually handling a project management aspect, and she's just like you guys. She did her bachelor's, she did her master's in English, and now she's like a project manager at Oyo. So of course, why not? You know, you can definitely go for it, and just make sure that you're connecting with all the recruiters on LinkedIn and just, like, you know, going for it. Okay, so let's look at the right answers here. What are the right answers? Okay, now, you know, these are very simple questions, okay? Ilya took the legend of the Holy Grail for the wasteland from ritual to romance. Where was he taking the title from the golden bough? And where is he taking the story of, the Holy Grail from ritual to romance? From ritual to romance, okay? So please remember, from ritual to romance is the work. The golden bough is the work from where he's taking the elements of symbolism, the story, the title that he was getting, okay? Let's come on to the next question. The early stories in James Joyce's Dubliners have Dash as protagonists. So Dubliners, a collection of short stories which is written by James Joyce. What are we able to see? Who all are protagonists? Remember when we were looking at The Catcher in the Rye by Salinger, we had spoken about how James Joyce, the portrait of the artist as a young man, is also an example. It is also an example of coming of age novels, especially, you know, how it's telling you about the teenage part as well, where you're oscillating, you're juggling between your feelings, okay? Let's see how many of you get the right answer. Yes. I can see Abhirami and Meenika Singh have given the right answer. It is dealing with children, okay? The early stories are dealing with children. You know, this is the same thing as Boyhood, Youth, which was written by, the writer of Tindrum. We're able to see how, and not just that, you know, a lot of people actually start with their trilogies. They're starting with their trilogies in a similar fashion. Okay, so that is, of course, there. But this is not a trilogy. This is a short story collection. And this short story collection is actually showing us the process of evolution in the Dublin societies. And the early parts are basically dealing with the children's stories. Okay, 21st question. Dash is the only play published by James Joyce. Dash is the only play which was published by James Joyce. Which is the only play published by James Joyce? Yes, very good. Very good, Hemlata. Very good, Zahida. All right, so when we are coming on to this question, what is the right answer? This question is such a favorite question, you know, when you talk about Haryana assistant professor exams, HP assistant professor exams, besides the HP set exam that they give, okay? Dash is the only play. It is the only play published by James Joyce. Exiles is the right answer. Exiles is the only play published by James Joyce. Okay, let's come on to the 22nd question. Crabbe's Last Tape is a famous play by. Very simple question. What is the right answer? What is the right answer? I think all of you should get this right in no time. In no time, you should get it right. Yes, Samuel Beckett is the right answer. Okay, Samuel Beckett is the right answer. So, Crabbe's Last Tape is a famous play by Samuel Beckett. Samuel Beckett is the right answer. Okay, let's come on to question number 23rd. Harry Rabbit Angstorm, who is the central character in the Rabbit series of the novels, was created by. Very simple question again. He is the person who's getting the Pulitzer Prize multiple times for the same story. And what is the right answer here? Come on, very, very quickly. We've just got a few more questions to cover. Okay, fantastic. This is the right answer. Okay, this is the right answer. John Updike is the correct answer. 24th question. Which among the following writers wrote the novel under the pen name of Victoria Lucas? Victoria Lucas was the pen name of which writer? Victoria Lucas was the pen name of which writer? Which writer was using the pen name of Victoria Lucas? So which writer is actually using this pen name of Victoria Lucas that you're able to see? Sylvia Plath, right, absolutely right. And last but not the least, don't forget to post your answers, okay? The 25th question, the Pulitzer Prize for Fiction is awarded to. The Pulitzer Prize for Fiction is awarded to. Who is getting the Pulitzer Prize? Just like the Sahitya Academy Award is given to Indian writers, right, or writers who are writing in multiple languages in India, within the Indian territory. So the Pulitzer Prize for Fiction is awarded to. Very good. It is given to the American writers. Okay, now let's very, very quickly come on to your your entire work that we're talking about, Crime and Punishment. Now, whenever we are discussing about Crime and Punishment, there is one particular thought that I want all of you to keep in mind, that Crime and Punishment is basically telling us, okay, Crime and Punishment is basically dealing with the mental anguish that is faced by Raskolnikov, how St. Petersburg society has made him a criminal, his criminality is actually compared with the innocence of his mother and sister. His mother and sisters are still presented to be very, very innocent, absolutely innocent. Okay, now whenever we are looking at this entire work, there are a few things that need to be very clear to all of you. And what are those few things? First of all, remember, Crime and Punishment was considered to be, point number one, it was considered to be a psychological thriller. Okay, it was considered to be a murder mystery. But in reality, it is a social criticism of the St. Petersburg society. It's a social criticism on the society of St. Petersburg. Why? Because the society was poverty-stricken. Because the society, everyone was becoming a drunkard, like people around Raskolnikov as well. Like we will be looking at Sonia's father. Sonia's father was a public servant. But because of his extreme alcoholism, which is the central focus of all the people who are living around St. Petersburg. So the first most important point is, it's of course a psychological thriller, it's of course a murder mystery in which we already know who has committed the crime, but it is also a criticism of the society. Point number one. Second point, this work is telling us about the mental anguish. It is discussing about the mental anguish as well as moral dilemmas. Please write this down. Mental anguish and moral dilemmas of this character called Raskolnikov. Whatever Raskolnikov is undergoing as a character. Third most important, just write down plot. The plot is a former law student. A law student who is not able to pay his fees. He is getting a letter from his mother telling him about how his sister is about to get married to this rich person, which further aggravates his position that, you know, he needs to contribute money. So what you're able to see is how this person comes to know, you know, what. So look at this. Okay, this person, Raskolnikov, says people like Napoleon, they have also committed crimes and they have still been treated as heroes. And thus he invents his own logic. He creates his own logic. And what does he do? He says, fine, I will kill the I'll kill the pawn broker and I will collect the money, because I'm collecting the money for the common good of other people. I'm connecting that money for the common good of other people. Now, because of certain, time constraints, I really want you to be very, very clear with a few pointers. And please write this down, okay? There was this question that had come. What is the name of Raskolnikov's mother? Pulcheria. Pulcheria is the mother of Raskolnikov. ओके, पुलचेरिया इज अ पर्सन हु वॉन्ट्स हर सन टू बिकम समथिंग. शी इज वेरी इनोसेंट, यू नो, शी इज द मॉरल सेंटर. शी इज द मॉरल सेंटर दैट यू आर हैविंग. हिज सिस्टर दुनिया, हिज सिस्टर दुनिया, दुनिया इज द सिस्टर. यू नो, बोथ ऑफ देम आर लुक वाइज द सेम. इवन रास्कलनिकोव इज अ वेरी चार्मिंग लुकिंग मैन. His sister Dunya is considered to be really beautiful. His sister Dunya is considered to be very, very beautiful and charming, and that is the reason, like, you know, a rich person has got ready to marry her. But what is the difference between Raskolnikov and Dunya? Raskolnikov has committed a crime and he is justifying the crime in his own mental mind. Dunya, on the other hand, is sacrificing. She can never kill anyone. She's rather sacrificing. So, you know, there is this morality of the rural people and how Raskolnikov has become corrupt because he's entered the St. Petersburg society. So, it is not a criticism of Raskolnikov, but it's actually a criticism of the St. Petersburg society. You know, Dostoevsky himself said that St. Petersburg is artificial. Please write this point down. He himself had written that St. Petersburg is artificial, Moscow is real. Moscow is real. These are two very famous Russian places that we are having. According to his opinion, St. Petersburg was corrupt, whereas Moscow was something which was absolutely unique. Now, when we are talking about the Russian society, we are dealing with a very feudal system. Russia did not deal with any sort of changes. Even in the 18th century, there was a feudal system that was followed. So whatever was happening in the other parts of the regions, in Europe in particular, nothing affected Russia at all. Now, when we are talking about Dostoevsky's Crime and Punishment, what I want you to remember is that this is the story which is presenting us the mental anguish as well as moral dilemmas that are faced by Raskolnikov. And that is what is making him human. That is what is making him human. Of course, he justifies it. Of course, he justifies it, but he's not a bad character. St. Petersburg has actually resulted in his degradation. It is St. Petersburg which is responsible for his degradation. It is because of St. Petersburg that we see him degraded as an individual. It is because of St. Petersburg that we are able to see that he's trying to justify a crime as gruesome as a murder. And he's not committing one crime but two crime, and then he's justifying those crime. He's justifying that particular heinous crime of murder because of the fact that he has developed this mentality of survival. You know, two very important, and this was a question that was asked, two very important themes that are introduced, the themes of nihilism as well as utilitarianism. The themes of nihilism as well as utilitarianism. I'm only concerned about the utility. I'm just concerned about the utility. I'm not connecting with anyone on the human front. I'm only looking at the utility that, you know, my friendship with so and so, how will it help me? My friendship with such and such person, how will that benefit me? I'm only concerned about the utility aspect. So this work was actually telling us in the format of the epicenters, of course, the St. Petersburg Society. In the form of St. Petersburg Society, we are able to see some very important. So St. Petersburg, we are able to see, is the epicenter of moral corruption. Okay, now, you know, that is what we are able to see. Some people considered it to be examples of utilitarianism and nihilism. Whereas some people said that, you know, it was because of poverty that he was trying to rob. Don't look at the fact that he has killed the pawnbroker. First see that he was under poverty. He was a law student who could not even pay his fees. He was a former law student who could not even pay his fees. And because he was not able to pay his fees, he's actually going and, you know, justifying the crime that he's committed. Okay, so please keep that in mind, that of course there is a psychological part that we are having to the tale. Of course we are having the criminal mentality that is getting that is getting depicted over here through the course of this work. But even more than that, certain things that you all should keep in mind are the fact that this particular work has been variously read. Not everyone has praised it, not everyone has criticized it. right? There has been a mixed response by everyone, and that is the reason at the beginning I told you point number one, it is not psychological thriller only. It is not a work which is a really path-breaking work of 19th century, which of course it is. It is a masterpiece, but more than that, it's criticizing St. Petersburg. It's criticizing the people around St. Petersburg. Right, that is what we are able to see. A very important character that you are having is Marmeldov. Now, why is Marmeldov important? Marmeldov is important because he's an alcoholic public figure, and alcoholism is very, very common. He is an alcoholic public figure. What is he? He is an alcoholic public figure, and alcoholism is something which is very, very common in St. Petersburg society. Everyone is engaging in alcoholism because of the fact that they want to survive, because of the fact that they want to literally win over the circumstances. And his drinking is ruining his own family. Because of his drinking practices, we're able to see that he's ruining his own family. His drinking is ruining his own family. Okay, so please keep that in mind. Do remember that, all right? His daughter Sonia is rather a moral center, right? His daughter is rather a moral center that we are able to see, because she's having a very strong religious faith. She is of course taking care of her family, and she is even getting into prostitution, but still we are able to see that somewhere down the line she's got a very strong religious faith that is ongoing. Okay, there is one more character, of course, as Raskolnikov, but there is also the character of Razumikhin. Please remember, this is a college student, the college friend of Raskolnikov. Why is he important? He is important because he's the voice of reason. So Razumikhin is the voice of reason. He is the voice of reason that we are having. Okay, he is the voice of reason that we have, that you all have to be carefully aware about. He is a person who's representing sanity. He is a person who's representing certain sort of, you can say, moral epicenter of the entire work. Otherwise St. Petersburg is a completely degraded society. Okay, so very simple story, how Raskolnikov has committed a crime and how he is trying to justify the crime that he has committed by quoting examples like Napoleon, that even when you're doing bad things, you can still have a clean conscience. That is what we are able to see over here. Okay, I will continue with some more parts over the I'll share it over the Telegram channel up until here, and rather I'll share the PPTs for the entire part. You can take a look at them. If you have any concerns, please feel free to let me know about it, and I will keep you guys posted about the next sessions. Okay, all right. So I will see you guys in the next class. 1 second. Yes, Ina, some of the names I will be sharing, which you need to do, so you can always go over them. All right, thank you so much. Take good care. Bye.